So back in June, a fan account for Failure asked if they could share my review of Fantastic Planet on Instagram, which of course was fine by me. They also put a snippet in their Instagram story, and lo and behold, that is the official Failure Instagram account. So obviously I have to make another Failure video after that, don't I? Now I've already established how great Fantastic Planet is, and if you missed that, then I don't know why you'd be watching this video, but if that's somehow the case, then go watch my first Failure video, or at the very least, listen to this album. Listen to it! For everyone else, let's start looking into the rest of the Failure discography by going back to the beginning. In the beginning, before Ken Andrews and Greg Edwards were two equally large cogs in the band's songwriting and performing machine, there was Andrews the singer, guitarist and lyricist, Edwards the bassist, and original drummer Robert Gauss. Their career seemingly got off to an incredible start as they signed to Slash Records, a subsidiary of Warner Brothers Music, in 1992, and then secured the services of renowned producer Steve Albini 8 months before he'd start mixing with Nirvana for their debut album Comfort. While the band themselves are credited as producers, having Albini in charge of the recording process pushed them more towards the more dry, claustrophobic production common in much of Albini's work, and this flat sound does not play to the band's strengths. Since Andrews didn't have the vocal character to compensate for the flatness, and is generally a rather average guitarist, at least compared to rising stars at the time like, say, Billy Corgan or Jerry Cantrell. But the band's trademark left-field chord progressions and angular lead guitar lines were present from the beginning, but they're hardly expanded upon much at all here. A lack of direct hooks isn't all that surprising, considering the bleakness of it, but what's the use if you can't really add something else that's a bit more memorable? What could I possibly say about a song like Kindred? Compared to anything on Fantastic Planet, that song is basically dead air. Comfort still has some moderately interesting tracks like Screen Man, Pro Catastrophe, Salt Wound, and the confusingly named Something, but the rest of it is more or less a bunch of throwaways. Especially Princess, which is basically just playing the same single chord for a minute and a half straight. And don't get me started on the lyrics. Maybe it's just me, but yeah, I'm not really vibing with those. Speaking of which, if you thought lyrics about heroin usage on Fantastic Planet were dark enough, then Comfort's gonna be even more of a shock. The general lyrical mindset can effectively be summed up with this one line from Pro Catastrophe. Not so much the rape part, but the violence? Yeah, there's plenty of that. So they still managed to be unique, but their differences with Albini and their general limitations in songwriting hold them back here. However, Princess is the only song on here that I truly never want to hear again. In fact, so far it's the only Failure song that I feel that way about. Except maybe a couple of the segues, but that's not really the same thing. So after the disappointment of Comfort, Robert Gauss quit the band, and the music industry altogether by the looks of it, with Andrews and Edwards finally starting to combine their efforts to devastating effect. Things were immediately promising as their label debated releasing the demos for the upcoming album as the album itself, but these demos used a drum machine, which the band only used as a placeholder before they could record the drum parts on a live drum kit, so they made sure that that didn't happen. In the end, Edwards stepped up and played most of the drums himself, finally revealing himself as one of music's ultimate multi-instrumental specimens, like Stephen Droz did the Flaming Lips before him. Meanwhile, four of the songs on the album feature a drummer named John Dargahi. Yeah, not much to say about him either. The resulting album was 1994's Magnified, introducing the band's now signature chunky distorted bass and screeching lead guitars swimming in effects. But more importantly, those unusual riffs and chord structures are finally starting to form some memorable songs. And while it exhibits more of Andrews' morbid lyrics like Comfort did, instead of performing under the same dark, drab mood and dynamics for much of the album, Magnified has songs like Frogs, the balanced, down-tuned riffs and the words of a mental patient with a bouncy, syncopated beat. The album starts with the short and sharp punchiness of Let It Drip, and closes with the bass-driven trudge of Small Crimes. So it feels like Edwards' greater involvement in the songwriting and performing process took their songs to a whole other level, and also diversified their overall sound. There's even some good old finger-picked acoustic guitar for the main riff of Bernie and the segue-esque section at the end of the title track, which segue 3 from Fantastic Planet is quite reminiscent of, if I'm honest. And whilst vocally Andrews came off a bit aimless on Comfort, on Magnified he really starts to get that sense of direction, bringing the earworm factor on tracks in particular like the title track, as well as Wonderful Life, Undone, and Empty Friend. Undone was the only official single from the record, and certainly feels like one of the more catchy and less dark songs from it, but I feel like they should have put more faith into Empty Friend as a single, because that song feels like the most poppy song they've ever written, besides maybe Stuck on You. But it may even be on the same level as Stuck on You. I mean, it even has a key change, for God's sake. If Nine Inch Nails could almost hit the US top 40 that year with this, then imagine what Failure could have done with this. By that logic, Undone should have become a hit as well. You just can't understand the music industry sometimes, can you? Also, I've seen some reviewers talk about Magnified as a metal album, or alternative metal, which I wouldn't particularly agree with, besides the track Wet Gravity with its chugging riffs and a coda with grinding, heavily flanged power chords. This still feels like the same spacey band behind Fantastic Planet, just with a somewhat less expansive sound. But to judge it based on that would be disingenuous, because it definitely stands on its own with some damn fine songs. Many bands would be extremely lucky to create an album like this, but for Failure, as it would soon turn out, Magnified was no fluke. In the years following their unfortunate breakup, the members of Failure kept themselves busy, with Andrews largely focusing on production and mixing alongside various side projects, Edwards generating buzz with his noise pop trio Autolux, and Scott drumming for bands like Veruca Salt, and also Christina Aguilera? Meanwhile, Troy Van Leeuwen, the touring guitarist that joined after the release of Fantastic Planet, is an official member of Queens of the Stone Age now. Good on him. But with their original cult following combined with a new generation of listeners wondering how this band could have possibly slipped under the radar of the alt-rock zeitgeist, Ken, Greg, and Kelly announced they were getting back together in 2013. Troy was not part of the reunion, which is understandable, really. But come on, Troy, you're really going to turn down Failure? I'd say you're the one who's missing out here. Anyway, with their first album post-reunion, The Heart is a Monster, how much of the band changed? Well, with Andrew's experience in recording and mixing, and the advancements in technology related to those practices, the music sounds cleaner and more dynamic than ever, with slightly more use of electronic programming and synths, and Andrew's has really refined his singing over the years. But beyond that, it's the same diverse and weirdly catchy band we know and love. Similar to Fantastic Planet, The Heart is a Monster has 18 tracks totaling just over an hour long, including the continuation of those numbered segues. Admittedly, the average song quality is lower, but compared to what one may normally expect from a band's newest album 15 or more years after their last album, Heart is a Monster is miles ahead. The album gives us some slightly more straightforward driving rockers like The Focus, AM Amnesia, and Come Crashing, alongside the more cerebral riffs and textures that you only get on a Failure album, like on Hot Traveller, Counterfeit Sky, Fairlight Error, and the floaty verses of Snow Angel. Meanwhile, Edwards provides co-lead vocals on Atom City Queen, creating a nice contrast between him and Andrew's singing in the chorus. And then out of nowhere, there's the piano-driven, almost musical number style of Mulholland Drive, which perhaps doesn't work quite as well as they hoped it would, but it certainly keeps things fresh and interesting. Unlike the segues, which the band seemed a little over-reliant on. Half of the last 8 tracks on the album are segues, so it doesn't really justify having a runtime similar to Fantastic Planet, personally. Still, much of the songs are pretty decent. Also decent are Petting the Carpet and I Can See Houses, 2 songs written back in the Comfort era, but they don't sound out of place on an album recorded in 2015 in the slightest. Funny how the best songs Failure wrote for Comfort didn't even make it onto the album, though the original recording of Petting the Carpet on their Outtakes album, Golden, admittedly does make me see why they felt it may not have been good enough. I mean, just listen to that bridge. It was a little unfair to say that the best song on the album is one that they wrote 20 years prior, but I Can See Houses is definitely my favourite out of these, with that cool as hell bass line, the simple but nice piano part, and the usual towering guitars and feedback. While I don't particularly feel the need to listen to The Heart is a Monster in full again anytime soon, the album still does enough to meet the standards that Failure set before their breakup. If the whole thing drags a little, then many of these songs still stand extremely well on their own, at least. Now we come to their latest album from last year, In the Future, Your Body Will Be the Furthest Thing from Your Mind. Not gonna lie, when I look at the title written down in full, it looks like something Jaden Smith would have tweeted 5 years ago. Sorry. I must say, the album doesn't feel too much different from The Heart is a Monster. Certainly not like they made the same album twice, but it definitely picks up where Monster left off, with the approach to production effectively being the same, and the differences in instrumentation, effects, and written melodies being mostly subtle. However, this album just grabs me more than Monster did. Something about these songs just feels more convincing and assured, like there's an even bigger sense of purpose behind it all. And also the fact that the segues don't make up a third of the track list probably helps. There are the usual non-stop chugging tracks like No One Left and Found a Way, and the still loud but more spaced out tracks like Paralytic Flow, Solar Eyes, and Force-Fed Rainbow, with the spaced out titles to match, as you can hear. Also, I want to mention Heavy and Blind, which has got some brilliant spacey tones, and I'd say the best riff in the modern era of Failure yet. But they also branch out a bit. The album opens on a bit of a curveball with Dark Speed, built on a straightforward drum machine or drum machine type beat, and featuring Andrews doing a deeper half-spoken vocal that's certainly a first for the band. And Distorted Fields has a modern indie dance kind of feel to it, in its busy drumming and thick bass groove. Then there's the quieter tracks like What Makes It Easy, which balances the usual full-body drumming with mainly acoustic guitar, Another Post-Human Dream, which is similar but slows the tempo even further, and throws in some swirling synths in a style that reminds me of Fake Plastic Trees a little. And for the diehards, there's Pennies, another re-recording of a track from Golden. Even these more subdued tracks are quite densely layered, further showing just how good Andrews and co. are at balancing out everything in the production without things becoming overblown. Also the case for Apocalypse Blooms, probably the most layered track on the whole album. And that album ends with The Pineal Electorate, a bombastic, lilting, piano-driven number in the vein of Mulholland Drive, only it feels much more immediately memorable, and also builds up to an epic finish. Plus, it's the first Failure song to fully feature Greg on lead vocals, a great album closer all round. In the Future, Your Body Will Be the Furthest Thing from Your Mind falls right in line with 21st Century Failure. But instead of stagnating, the band sound even stronger than before, even without having to majorly alter their sound. So in conclusion, if you like Fantastic Planet, then absolutely listen to the rest of Failure's albums. Comfort is the only album that feels like it lacks something, but if you're more into something darker, then early Failure may be even more to your liking. And they've become one of those rare bands that reunited after a long hiatus that have made music that holds up well compared to the music from before it. Once you're done with those albums, there's the compilation Golden that I've already mentioned, mostly made up of four-track demos from, I believe, the Magnified era, but they're much more fleshed out than you'd expect. Some of the tracks almost have an industrial Nine Inch Nails kind of vibe, probably in part due to the drum machines. Similar stuff is available on Essentials, a best-of type compilation that also features demos for every track from Magnified, plus their interesting pre-Comfort self-released singles. They actually don't sound all that different from the demos from Golden. Albini must have really fucked with their whole production process after all. So if you still had any doubts over this stuff being worth your time, don't. It's all worth it. Listen to all of it. Preferably right now. Thank you.